Alright, so treasures. Bottled ship. This is the one that gives you an extra treasure choice. I suppose it's like C or B as far as two costs go. I think it's definitely okay. It just sucks because it's not giving you any immediate advantage, which can be an issue in async. If you didn't watch my other tier list videos here, should specify I'm ranking these for high MMR async play through January. So that caveat is there. I don't know. It definitely helps. It's also nice because sometimes, you know, I mainly evaluate these twos for the value that they give you early, but that's not the 100% evaluation. Sometimes you do triple a two later in the game, and this would be a very high value two cost treasure to get if you had a slot to spare. I don't know that I would replace like an actual mid to late game treasure with it, but you know, it's okay, but it doesn't give you any immediate advantage, which can be somewhat of a downside. And it could be a long time before it gives you an advantage, and it may not give you a relevant advantage, is the problem with it. It's just one extra choice. It's really good on Fisher King, I can tell you that. It could be good if you get it really early on Apprentice before you get your treasure, but it's at its best with Fisher King for sure. Getting a choice of two sixes very much eliminates, you know, if one of them's Hurricane, the other one's something usable at least. Or at least something you could make use of. I think as far as two costs go, I would go S on Cobbled Roads. I think it's even been nerfed. It used to give two, and I think in the patch they rebuffed it to two. I don't know about that. I think I read that. At the time of me recording this, I haven't actually played the new patch. I will soon, but it's S even in the old form. It's for sure S if it's two rolls, but even just one extra roll per round as far as two cost treasure. I mean, the context here, I think it's something I've brought up before, but I just don't think two cost treasures are that good. They're very weak. So it's S in the context of being a two cost treasure. Like, it might not be that good in a general sense, but it's certainly a lot better than maybe all of the other twos in a general sense. I mean, it's a free roll at the start of every single turn. That's really good. It allows you to find extra units, it allows you to do everything in this game that you want to do. Crossroads is a similar idea. I just don't think it's quite as good as a Cobbled Roads, but it's still pretty good for a two cost treasure. It's like a worse version of the Weird Compass. However, for a two cost, it's pretty good. Honestly, I could argue S for this as well, but and unlike Cobbled Roads, if you get it at the beginning of a round, it does give you immediate benefit, whereas a Cobbled Roads doesn't take effect till next round. So there is some times where it actually feels okay over the Cobbled Roads, but I would generally always take the roads over it anyway. Just getting an entire extra roll for free is generally going to be useful than an extra unit in the shop. But, you know, those are good two costs. And another incredible two cost. This one is S tier. For sure. I mean, 3-3 food, every single unit you buy is absolutely bonkers as far as two cost treasures go. It's so good. I mean, it's better than Cobbled Roads, probably. Certainly if I get it early. I would never, I don't think there's any treasure I ever take over this in a general sense in async. You know, this is just going to go so far to helping you. This one will last, form is better than a lot of threes, I would say. It'll be something that provides me value all the way up to like level 5. It is that good. The tempo it provides is just wild. And then we get to the less good tempo treasures, but for the same reasons that I ranked Good Leprechaun pretty good, I would say that this is the best of the, like, aura 2-cost tempo treasures, since there are just generally good. I mean, I could even say B with it. I would mostly take this over the treasure if I had good units, and most of the time I would. You know, I probably have Frog, I might have an Angel, might have Shield Page. I don't know that it's very good with Shield Page. You don't really want Shield Page to fight, but Angels, Farmers, all of these things have the good tag, and a 1-1 on them is decent for as far as a 2-cost goes. And the cake is, I don't know, between, is it as good as the clover? It's the same thing, it's like a tempo treasure, but it doesn't help you win, it only helps you tie. Unless you're buying a Hansel, which even with this cake I wouldn't recommend. It's probably C. I don't know. It certainly can save you health, but it doesn't allow you to punish the lobby. Because here's the thing in Async. I did talk about some lobbies. You'll go to round 16 and the entire lobby is still alive. And you do have yourself to blame a lot of those times if you're only tying. Like, if you're not actually putting the hurt on and winning fights, then you're allowing every board to survive. And this is not going to help you kill anything. Whereas this will. And all of these definitely will. So I think it is good to save your own HP, but you can't ignore the fact that you do kind of want to be putting damage on people. And it doesn't do that. And this is the same story. I think in terms of surviving, it's better than cake, but it doesn't have any, at least the cake makes Hansel takeable sometimes, so that's the trade-off, but they're about the same. They're just gonna help you tie fights. I would say back when Van Helsing was a thing, this would be like A or S, because that's something I would just keep in my hand all the way to the end game. And if I went Hunters, which I would often, Van Helsing now became really good, no matter who you were. So I do still miss me old Van Helsing, but such is life. And then the Ice Storm, I guess B. There's only really two reasons to take it. One is if you have a Owl. There's three reasons to take it, I guess. I mean, on two, the only reason is Owl, but like, I would never take it if I didn't have an Owl either in my hand or at least in the shop. And then at level three, there's two reasons to take it. It would be the Sorceress with range, Mage, or the Treant that gives you attack. You can scale your whole board with that, and that's pretty good. That's the only reasons really to take it, though. Otherwise, you're not really doing anything. It's like, it's not helping you out. You know, you're taking it with Owl and the Mage in order to scale them, because it counts as a spell. You're not actually caring about the effect of the spell. And then with Trent, you're caring about the effect of the spell. But otherwise, it's like, it's not helping you at all to take this. But because it has those upsides, I would say overall it's a B, even if I have to skip it quite often. I mean, it's good with one of the best two drops there is, so that by default kind of makes it good. Library card, I think, is quite good. At various times, I would put it at S. I would say A for now. I think back when you could get experience spells that were easy to proc, this was S. But right now, I don't think that the 3-cost experience spells are easy to proc, but still the 4-cost ones are. And by the way, I think I like that the 3-costs aren't easy to proc. They shouldn't be easy to proc. But that's just kind of why it's maybe only at an A right now. I would still definitely take it over these others in a general sense. It's just a generally useful thing. It's similar to Crossroads in the Valley, right? Instead of an extra unit, I'm getting extra spell. And it doesn't matter if you're mages or not, library card will always be useful, just having an extra card, and it's one that could last all the way to the late game in a lot of cases. Then we have Mana Stone. This is one that I've brought this one up at various points as being just incredibly weak, and people just don't agree with me, so I guess we'll just agree to disagree. But to me, only getting one extra mana and no other effect is fucking abysmal. Like, you can't even make use of it 9 out of 10 times early game. And it's like, I don't know, you compare it to the 3-cost similar treasures, and it's like it doesn't even sniff the fart of them. Whereas like a lot of these other ones that have similar things I could make arguments that they're similar, they can be approaching the power level of 3s in some cases, but this one absolutely does not. I think that this thing is so far below the power level of what it should be that I've suggested drastic changes to it that I think are legit, but nobody agrees, so whatever, I don't care. I'll just continue to never take it, essentially, and I'll be fine with that because it's horrible. I would go, I guess, A. This is a very hard one to actually rank in a tier list, though, because it's like, it doesn't really fit into a tier list. It's like you will take it if you are apprentice or an amateur. You'll take it. Maybe if you're Fisher King and you got it offered later, like once you're level 4, for example. Or maybe you take it if you just got really bad choices for your starting hero and you want to change out of it. Or if you're Daedalus, it's really good with something like Daedalus or Savitri. So like with those, it's S. It's like you'll take that over pretty much everything, but with everyone else, it's not necessarily worth taking. Like if I got a character that was good, I'm not going to take that. If I got a character that's early game tempo, I'm not going to take that. So I don't know. I'll still leave it at A, though, I guess, even though it probably averages out more to B or C. It doesn't, it, long story short, it doesn't matter where I put this. It doesn't have any use in a tier list. You know which characters you're going to pick with it, and you know that the other characters you probably just won't pick it with. I suppose I'd go C with the tower. It might be better than C, but I find it hard for me to pick it. A lot of the time, over some other stuff that just gives me immediate value. The problem is, it just takes quite a while for it to go. But theoretically, I see it as a one and done treasure. I'm usually not going to get multiple procs out of it. But I usually see it as like, okay, I'm going to try to prep this thing and then double cast an experience spell, and then I've gotten my value out of it, and that's a lot of value, by the way. The only problem is, up until then, it's doing nothing for you, which in async can be a problem. But the ceiling on this thing is probably the highest of any of these 2 costs. Yeah, and I can't remember if this one was getting buffed or not. Maybe it is, but it could be better. I know it's not lower than a C. I'm ranking it kind of at the lowest that it possibly might be, but it could very well be B, A, or S. I don't pick it enough, though, to put it higher than C. But maybe I should. I'm willing to say on that one that it's maybe just misevaluated, because I don't take it enough to know. I think in async that the piggy bank is like D or F. I just don't think you have the luxury to hold gold to get minor benefits out of it, really. You have to hold a lot of gold to get a serious benefit out of this. I guess even if you're not cashing in on the econ thing, you could argue that holding gold at the end of a level and then spending all of it in the next level is good, but like, I just don't know in async that the health you'll lose in that scenario is worth it. But it's definitely, it falls into the category of like, it's not going to help you come back from a bad situation, but it might help you stomp a high roll situation even better. But I don't know. It's just tough. I think if Icarus is good in a meta, then Piggy Bank also is good in a meta. They kind of go hand in hand, same with Entrepreneur, obviously. It just depends on what you can get away with, and I don't think you can get away with enough consistently for Piggy Bank to be that good. But it obviously has a really high ceiling. The playpen, this is one that gives 1/1 to all level 2 and 3 characters. It should be better than it is. I just find that because you're not... It's just such a temporary tempo treasure. Like, it just doesn't... Like, if I compare playpen to this, for example, this is just so much better, the farming one, because... You know, you're getting more actual stats from the farming, even if they don't last on the unit that you buy. That doesn't really matter, because you can keep just, you know, buying several units a turn. So you're getting more tempo already early from this. They both have the advantage of working on, like, all of the early units, but this has the advantage of working on every unit throughout the game. Where this doesn't, and honestly, once you get to 4, this falls off so fast, which is why I think I put it to a C, whereas, like, this could remain a B. They're both, I mean, the other thing here is that, like, a 1-1 quickly becomes rather irrelevant by level 4, so both of them have that problem. But at least this one continues to provide value through level 4, whereas this one doesn't really. I find that through level 4, you quickly need to transition to mainly 4s. Maybe you'll have a 3 and 2 here and there. But I would probably generally take this over them. So maybe we'll just rank them at about the same. We're probably splitting hairs between these two. I do think this one is worse than this, but not enough to be a different tier, probably. And then we get the evil, or no, the slay thing. It's either B or C. It always sounds better than it should be, and it'll be meta-dependent. Maybe in the next patch when slay is supposedly better, this is a higher pick, but the way I see it, it just reads... parrot will gain 2 attack on death, which is a pretty good deal if you have a parrot. But if you don't have a parrot, there's no reason to take this, because there's, at least in the patch that I'm evaluating this tier list for, there was never any reason to take the 3-cost slay unit. There was never any reason to take the 4-cost slay units. I guess there sometimes was reason to take the slay item, so it could have synergy with that. So I think it's very... much in the middle of B and C, kind of like this one, whereas these feel solidly in B. These don't really, but I'm not going to make a new tier for them. It's not like that important. And then I'll put this one in the C for the same reason that Bruni is worse than Leprechaun, the same reason as this is worse than this. But it's still takeable. It's just not a great tempo treasure. Most of the two costs aren't great tempo treasures. I could even argue all of these are C, but they feel a little bit better than these. And then this one's pretty bad. Because you're not even getting the 1-1 on it. So it's like, it's essentially this, just worse. It's like, the only advantage is then once you get to level 4, you're getting a measly 1 attack on them. It's like, okay. Pretty irrelevant by that point in the game. I could even go F on this one. But yeah, I think Mana Stone probably would deserve its own tier for the 2 drops. And then this one is getting buffed from what I hear. I still thought it was an okay 2-drop. It's pretty slow, obviously, but they're going to make it 1 turn faster from what I read. And maybe it's an S at that point, honestly. It's probably better than any of those Bs. I would generally take it over these. So it's probably A in the old form. If it was A in the old form, it's definitely S in the new form, then I'll probably be taking that shit all the fucking time. But yeah, it's a 3-cost. It's a delayed 3-cost, which is fine. Now we get to 3s. Damn, this video is going to be another long one too, huh? I think it's a tempo treasure. I give it like a B. It was actually a lot better back when Sinbad was a thing. Because once you got to 4, it could give you a lot of stats to your stuff. I guess you could still use it with like a Radiant Fairy or something, but I don't really know that you would want a Radiant Fairy in slot 1 is the problem. But it's just generally okay. I have mentioned that generally you want attack instead of health in this game, but there's probably a exception to the rule with this treasure because it gives you a shitload of health. At that point, you're basically making that unit potentially 2, sometimes 3 for one-ing when it would have originally just 1 for one'd. So it's definitely a decent thing, but it isn't always good. You know, I think against the most high rolling of lobbies, it still can be largely irrelevant, sadly, because there's so much attack damage coming in on you. And they also have so much health that if you're only getting health, you're still not dealing with that aspect of things. But yeah, it's generally a decent one. Let's see, this is Baby Mimic. Baby Mimic is pretty good. This shitty thing is it's, you know, it doesn't give you any immediate benefit. And I really don't like the interaction where if it's your third treasure, you can't just replace itself to pick up the new treasure. I don't really like that interaction, that you actually have to replace one of the other 2 treasures. So that's probably what leaves it out of an S for me, is just the combination of those 2 factors. Otherwise, it's by far the highest ceiling of any of the 3-drop treasures, really. Like, it's pretty damn good, and you don't have to be that greedy with it. If you can be greedy with it, all the better. You know, getting some 5s or 6s with it, or dare, if heaven forbid you get a 7 with it, can be bonkers, but just getting a 3 or a 4 with it is something you should settle for most of the time, I think, in async, because you don't have the time to greed that late on treasures. Or at least you don't have the time to purposely deny triples or skip treasures just to try to be so greedy to get a 5 or 6 with it. You know, I mean, even on something like this, for example, it's great. It's like you're getting so much health out of it. And then Broker's Brooch. I'm just not that high on this one. I know they changed it so that items count toward it as well. So, like, theoretically, you could gain gold by buying and, you know, spam buying and selling one cost items, but there's only the 2 1 cost items, and they don't show up that often past level 3, especially level 4. I'm getting a level 3 treasure probably toward the end of level 3, if not level 4, so. Really, its main thing is like, do I have a goose or not? If I don't have a goose, I don't really know why I would take this. Now, if I do find a goose, it's S tier, obviously. So it's another treasure where it's like, kind of like the doll, where it's like, I have a situation that it'll be good with, but in a general sense, it's just not good. I don't think. So yeah, that's the BB. Then Chrono Crystal, I'd probably give it like an A. God damn it, CC Cleaner. Okay, 1 second. Okay, it's gonna fade away. No, nope, it's not. Okay, so Chrono Crystal, I think it's in async very good because you're very often dying. Which is maybe hypocritical that I don't rank Savitri that high, but I think the context here is I can take Chrono Crystal with an actual good hero, which is a world of difference. Whereas with Savitri, I'm through the most devastating async levels in the game. If I didn't get Matryoshka doll, then I'm pretty far behind. Whereas I can get this on an okay character and just survive the bullshit. You know, just. I could have a good build going, but then I run into Mr. Golden King Icarus or something that was ahead on experience and put together some Golden King board like a whole level ahead of the people, and then I face them when I'm on 15 health and I lose all my 15 health, even though I had a good build going. Well, Chrono Crystal can prevent that bullshit and allow me to keep going. It also has really good synergy with some of the heroes, such as Hercules, to really guarantee that you get the max value out of their hero power. But in a general sense, I am never sad to just take a Chrono Crystal and hold it. And I would say in async, in sync, I often would take it and maybe just never use it. But in async, I would say the majority of the time that I take it, I end up proccing it. And a majority of the time that I proc it, it's the difference between me getting sixth and first a lot of the time. I may even consider it S in that sense, but who's to say that because I took that instead of something that gave me immediate benefit, maybe that contributes to me having it get procced? There is that argument, and it might be a valid argument. So I think I leave it at A, just because it doesn't actually give me any benefit immediately, but it is giving me a tangible benefit to allow me to stall one extra turn, which is usually a very pivotal turn for builds that I want to put together that usually have to spend some time between level 5 and 6 forming, you know, just forming up, whether it be farmer or fluff or something like that. And this does wonders for helping you actually survive the critical turn where you go from nothing to something, or dwarfs even, you know, dwarves. So I really do think Chrono Crystal's pretty top tier in async. Potentially S, but. And I gotta be honest, this is probably one of the most overrated treasures in the game, especially in async. I take it way too often, and I always think back and I'm like, I could have just took a good 3-cost treasure. Instead, I took something that is never scaling the 2-2 because I'm losing or tie. I'm like tying every fight still. Or even if I win, only the egg survives. So it's like, okay, I'm getting a 2-2 on the egg. Often it's my only upgraded unit anyway, so I'm only getting the 3-3 on the egg. It's like, dude, I could have just took any of the other 3 costs offered here and had a much better time. I do think that the egg treasure is incredibly overrated. Now, if the rare times that I can win and still have more units than the egg survive, then it's good. But in my experience, that's like not the norm. Not even close to the norm. Like, I can maybe count on one little hand the times that that has been the case. And even then, I don't even know it's better than like a storybook or something. So there's just better three drop. Most of the three drop treasures are better. God, there are so many treasures. I'm going to be at this all day. I would just go see with this, I guess. It's only one. You're giving up a three cost treasure just to get one higher on another treasure. Which sometimes can be pretty good, but I would have to rank it about the same as the ship. It's like you have the same problem. If you don't find another treasure relatively soon, then you completely wasted your treasure choice to a certain degree, in my opinion. And if you do get an early choice, then it does play. Now, if there's always the dream where you can get like a six cost treasure and turn it to a seven or something, but in my experience, that just is not realistic in async. You need help, and you need help from treasures. And if you're delaying, you know, similar to the baby mimic, if you're just purposely delaying your three or four cost treasures to try to greed it for something later, I think that will spell defeat more often than not. But for what is it, it's okay. And I think this is like one of the worst three cost treasures. A 1/2 stat line just isn't that good for a three cost treasure. I mean, look at all the other stuff I could be getting with it. It's like, I guess it's not F, it's D. But it's very low D. I mean, it's on the level of something like this, I would say. Yeah, I don't think it's F. But it's pretty bad. Like I said, it's like, maybe if it was a 2/1, it'd be better. You would just rather have attack than health, in my experience. So you're getting like a level 2 treasure worth of hell of attack. And then I guess the level 3 portion of it is you get one measly extra health. Ooey. Pretty bad treasure. The Seer's Sphere is the equivalent of the ball from SBB. It's tough because I think in a general sense I just rank it as a C. Which again goes back to this being a horrible treasure because this gives you 4 mana. But I just don't find that I will ever be able to use that mana in most cases unless I'm very hardcore into mages. Like I have to have the hat already. Or Odin's Ravens. Otherwise, it's a three-cost treasure that doesn't really get much synergy until level 5 when you can get the Crystal Maiden. So, it's just an awkwardly placed treasure, but I'm not going to say that it hasn't popped off for me. The problem is, if you speculate on it and it doesn't work out, then you wasted your three cost treasure. So it feels similar to like the bean in that sense. Or even the bottled treasure, because it really doesn't give you any advantage really at all. Like, yeah, it'll refresh your targeted spells and allow you to cast more. But you don't have enough gold to make that relevant. So you really do need spell reduction combined with it to be good. And it all just averages out to a C. I mean, it's like when it pops off, it's S. But if you take it and it does nothing, it's obviously an F tier. And it does have other synergies. Technically, it has synergy with the Yuck the Yak, but I think Yuck the Yak is such a bad unit that I wouldn't even... If I saw a Yuck the Yak in my shop and I had this treasure choice, then maybe I take it. But I would never speculatively take it, hoping for a Yuck the Yak. But it does have really good synergy with the Mana Catalyst, which we'll get to eventually, which is a 4-cost treasure, this one. Then you're, like, really happy that you got the both of them. But it's... The problem is, if it's your first 3-cost treasure, it's very hard for me to take this. Because it's completely speculative at that point in the game. It really has to be my second or even third treasure offering for me to take it. and feel good about it, I guess. And then we got the Aura Bell. I'd go like D tier. It is technically okay if you get it right early in level 3, but if it's like late level 3 or especially level 4, I'm just never taking this. It just doesn't do enough considering I have to play 2 entire units down. It goes back to the same problem as Ugly Duckling. It's like, it's good through level 3 and that's about it. Like, otherwise, playing down units for that stat line increase is almost never worth it. I think it's a 4 over 3, if I'm not mistaken, which is really good for a few rounds. I will admit that it feels like an A-tier treasure if you get it right at 3. But then you quickly just have to stop using it. It's like it quickly becomes a thing where the math just works out that fielding a full board would have been better than getting a 4-3 to playing down 2 units. But if Pirates ever gets brought back to life by Evanescence, this will become a good treasure again because it's pretty good with the crew member. And then you can pair them with Duelists and Sinbads and stuff, and that actually allows it to remain relevant through level 4. And that's a big thing with the 3s. They need to be relevant through level 4 to have a good rating. And it just isn't relevant through level 4. And actually, I rank the Dagger pretty similar to the Helmet. I think it's a little bit better, even though it doesn't give as many stats. The attack, I still think, is generally more useful than the HP, except it's not enough to be in a different tier. And there are definitely times I've taken the health over the attack. It will make sense in some cases to do that. But I don't know. The nice thing about the Dagger is it's really good with like the Cats. Or a Duelist or a crew member, like you just can resummon a high attack thing and have it attack twice, or you get the double attack value out of it. Whereas I could technically do that same thing with this, except if my unit doesn't innately have attack, which most of the time a Cat wouldn't, and most of the time a Duelist or a crew member wouldn't. I'd have to have an upgraded sword square behind it for it to ever match the value of that in that case. So it really is just situational on what's in your hand or in your shop by the time you see these. But I do think Dagger generally is more useful, but not just ever so slightly. And then there's the Slay Treasure. I'm going to give it an F just in the context of where Slay is. Like I said, Parrot, through level 2 and 3, Parrot's the only Slay unit worth fielding, at least in the patch that I played. And even through level 4, I don't think any Slay unit is worth fielding. So really it just comes down to like, I mean, maybe it's still better than that, but I wouldn't recommend taking it in a general sense, just ever. It's like, it does technically facilitate a Slay build, but you speculatively take this thing, and the only way you can immediately get value out of it is by taking shitty units, and this treasure does not make those shitty units any better. Maybe if I'm ranking this high because of Parrot, though, this deserves at least a D. I guess I can extend that branch, but again, this is a 2 and it's good with a 2. This is a 3 and it's only good with a 2. So, and it's still not even, I have to slay to get it to work, which doesn't always happen, whereas I just have to die for this to work, which is much better. So, I don't know, I actually bring this back down to there. I don't know that this helps Parrot enough for me to care. So it's like, it would only really become good once you get to level 5, in my opinion, but it's a level 3 waiting room for level 5. Like, I'm not going to speculate on that. Now, if for some reason I am into some sleigh shit, then it becomes enticing, but I think it's a really bad, really bad. It's just the state of sleigh. If sleigh is better, then it's good, but it's just, from what I've seen, it wasn't. You could argue the same thing of this treasure. You know, because Stars is just the end-all be-all, this is a god-tier treasure. Now, I think in the new patch with Dandelion gone, maybe it's not as good, but, and Star Child only generates one star, so I'd actually suspect that this is like a C-tier in the new patch. You can probably bet money on that, but because I'm judging just what I know, which was the past month of playing, we're going to say that this was definitely an S-tier 3-drop treasure because of Stars. But yeah, as a 3-cost treasure, I don't think it's very good anymore with both Dandelion and Star Child kind of not generating stars anymore. If I had to wait all the way till Titania to generate stars, then it's only really useful on Puck, and it's not even that useful on Puck. I would go like A on the storybook. It's very similar, I think, in value to these. It's not quite S, but it's really good. A 2-2 to every single shop unit, and they fixed the bug to make it actually affect your current shop. So yeah, it's really good. I don't know that there's really much to go into on that one. It's just, I mean, compare that to this. Come on. And now this is one I think a lot of people like, and I don't. This to me is F tier. It doesn't even have a good interaction with like Mimic or stuff like that. And it doesn't, you know, it only reduces the cost on the extra item. It doesn't even reduce the cost on the first item. So unless you're very specifically going dwarfs, I don't see a big reason to take this. Even though if it's late game and I'm taking a 3, then sometimes I'll take it. I will admit that, but it doesn't. For a 3-drops are still early enough that I'm not going to rank something that much based on its late game viability. I really want immediate value, and this doesn't give me immediate value at all. I've regretted it every time I've taken it. Weird Compass is no longer a 3. I think the hat's pretty good. And it does. Obviously, you don't need to be mages, but if you got the mages, ooh, that's really good then. The reduction of the spell cost really makes it so much smoother to do your turns. And even if you're not mages, I'll often take this if the other choices aren't good, because you can still just like get free health or get an X. Even if you're not, you can get. Just some little buffs here and there. In a way, it's almost like a storybook, very similar in value sometimes in what it can get you. And it opens up the whole mage treasure chain. If I have this now, I can take this and really, really go to town, you know? Especially the earlier I get it, because there's just more and more one-cost spells that are targeted at that point. Or even 0. Where are we at? That was the last 3? I believe so. And now we're to the 4s. You know, this is just such a good treasure, the Weird Compass. It was obviously an S tier at 3 cost, and they nerfed it to 4 cost, and it's still S tier. It doesn't really matter. I'll give up tempo to take it often, because it is tempo in itself, even if I'm on level 4 when I get it, because think of it this way. As we've mentioned, most of the 4s suck, so instead of just getting some stats to everything on board, why don't I just search for the actual good tempo units? Same thing with 5, and then by the time you're to 6, it's very good in its ability to get your build together so much faster, and put together treasures so much faster. It's God tier. It'll always be God tier. You could make this a 5 cost and I'd still rank it S. If it were a 6 cost, I would rank it maybe an A or a B. That's how good that treasure is. I hope they don't nerf it, because it's just fun to get on 4. But if they nerfed it, I would have totally understand it. Like I said, I think it's still S as a 5 cost. And this is a weird one because, you know, I rank treasure hamster so low, and this is just a worse treasure hamster for a 4 cost treasure, yet I find it to be a pretty good 4 cost treasure. I think it's somewhere between B and A. For async, I'd probably give it a B. For sync, I would give it A. For async, it's hard for me to justify it because I do need that tempo help. But if I think I got a good chance of getting an immediate second follow-up triple, then I'll be more inclined to take it. And I'm never sad to have it, necessarily. It's just, you know, it allows you to get treasures ahead of curve, which is a good thing, generally. It does suck that if you replace it, it loses you gold, but that doesn't really happen that often, I feel, in my experience. And I don't really know what else there is to say about it. This got moved to 5. Oh, wait, there's... I swear it's, like, rearranging the shit on me. So this is Broken Spell Reflector. This one used to suck, but it actually got a buff, and I think it's pretty decent now. I do still think you kind of need mages or mage treasures to really make use of it. Otherwise, you're spending quite a lot of gold just on spells and also not getting much passive benefit out of it if you're not running mage units and or you don't have those treasures, but or maybe at least you could get the book item, you know, the one that can just scale anything. But if you have any of those, Broken Spell Reflector is pretty good. You're getting what, like a 3 cast every other cast. I just wish there were a little more targeted spells for it to actually interact with. And it can be a downside sometimes. Like, you don't want to... Like, sometimes I want to cast the sacrifice unit for experience spell, and it can just eat your entire board, or sacrifice unit for health. I mean, you can YOLO it, but it could lose you the game if you get too bad of a hit there. But it could actually also just be really good there. You get way ahead on experience, and maybe you just live with that. But just it's a generally good treasure now. It was a really good change that they made. Then Double Caster, I think, would be similar value. They both have their conditions that need to be met. You know, the Double Caster needs cheaper spells, whereas the broken thing needs targeted spells. I think you're about as likely to find either of them through most of the game. So they're going to give you similar value. Both are going to be great with mages, and maybe not so great otherwise. You'll notice the 4-cost treasures are very mage-centric. If you're looking to do mage stuff, try to combine 4s. So, Immutable Idol did change, but I'm ranking it on what it used to be. I don't know that it really needed to change. I don't know that it really is S. It's obviously S on Amateur, which is the best, most common thing, and it'd be really good on Treasure Hamster. But other than that, if you actually get it on curve, I feel like it's more like A, but even then, I think it's still pretty good. So yeah, not hugely worth rating anymore since it drastically changes in the new patch, but for what it's worth, I think it was an S tier treasure. Being a 14-14 is a lot of stats to add to quite a lot of units. Such a good one with Chameleon, or just ranged units, Radiant Fairy. So many units that it just was so good with. had some downsides, but I found that I could usually work around them pretty easily. And then Mana Catalyst. This one got a gigantic buff. It might be too powerful now. It's definitely an S-tier treasure now. You know, just four cross treasures pretty good, aren't they? Like, we got a lot in the S, A, and B. And honestly, those mage ones are S or A when you're mages. It's just when you're not mages, they're not necessarily so enticing to see. But yeah, Mana Catalyst is wild. You can combine. We'll look at Odin Ravens here as well. But if you can combine it with the Seer Sphere or the Odin Rains, it becomes insane. And it's okay with the even the hat. It's like a little bit of an extra. I don't know that I like it with hat though, because I feel like if I'm taking it with hat, now I'm losing most of what makes hat good. I don't think the extra mana is the biggest portion of what makes hat good. It's that I can cast spells cheaper. But now I'm kind of incentivized not to do that because I have Mana Catalyst, so it's not the greatest. Whereas with the Seer's Sphere, I could just take that with the Mana Catalyst, and I don't really care that I'm not casting spells. I'm like, yeah, I'm getting like a million stats to my board. So but even if I never have those, you know, the high rolls of like Odin's Ravens or Seer Sphere to combine with it, even if it's just two mana, that's still like, okay, I'm just gonna not cast spells unless they're a really good spell. I'm just gonna not cast spells, and I'm getting a 4/6 to my entire board. That's ridiculously good for a four cost treasure as far as tempo goes. And it also affects resummons. I mean, that's wild. I'm going to go A on this one. This is the Merlin's something where it casts random spells at the start of every fight. You know, I mentioned it before. There are some. It's very sim. I rank it the same tier that I rank the book, the monster book or whatever, for the units, because it's the same concept. It's like, yeah, there are some games where it just casts you some bullshit. And that's not very useful. But if you do have mages, at least you're getting some procs there. Or if you have the mage book items, at least it's helping you scale there. And that's something to be said. But here's the thing, a lot of the time, you know, you're technically just as likely to get the useless spells as you are to get the useful spells. And there are way more useful spells than there are useless spells. You know, and even in a context of like scaling, like if you were to take this versus a tempo or scaling treasure, sometimes you just get lucky and get God's Rays cast, and it makes it a tempo treasure essentially. Even if it's Rite of the Valkyries, which is just a temporary buff, it's kind of like a tempo treasure at that point. So it's like it's wildly variant in what it will do, but the odds are in your favor that it does something good, and it keeps being useful all the way till the end game. Like, it's not one I really need to remove, considering I can randomly get Starlight Strike, or I can randomly get Pygamore from it. I mean, that is quite good into any matchup. And the Odin's Ravens, I think, is you know, it's just the counterpart to the hat here. I think it's a similar value. It does the same cost reduction, but it gives you a ton of mana to go with it. I don't know. I'm tempted to put it in B, but I do think if I'm just generally thinking about things, I would rather have Odin's Raven. Like, if I never had any mage treasure at all, and I saw these three offered, or these three offered, I'm taking these every time over these two, in my personal opinion. Unless there's a specific reason not to. Because this is just going to allow me to, you know, cast a bunch of free shit. And that's good. Same with this, it's just giving me free shit. Whereas these really do require investment for me to use. So yeah, I think that's why I probably rank them higher. But in an actual mage build, it's really gonna depend on your situation on which one you want to take over the other. And then Pirate Map. I would probably put it around the B. I mean, this is a tough one for tier lists, right? I would never want to take this if I wasn't already having two other treasures. I'm not a fan of being that greedy in async, especially. I don't even like to do that in sync. However, if I have two treasures and now I'm doing that, prepping it to actually pop, then it's pretty good. This is how you get 7-cost treasures way ahead of curve, or even a 6-cost treasure ahead of curve, I'm more than willing to do. And that's a really good deal. So it's maybe not that useful to put in a tier list because you know your situation. You know if you have two treasures or not. And it'd be, if I do have two treasures, even the good stuff here, it'd be hard for me to take anything over the map at that point. But I would probably take these S tiers over it in a lot of cases still, especially if I didn't feel that solidified in my position. And then Power Bag, that did get buffed to a 4-2 instead of a 3-1. And as a 4-2, it's pretty good, just like B tier. I mean, it's certainly no Mana Catalyst. It's certainly no Immutable Idol as far as tempo goes. And like I said, this could probably end up giving you more stats than that on most runs. But it's not unusable. It's just an okay tempo treasure. It's skewed in the right direction, unlike this. You know, it's skewed toward attack, which is what you want. But it's not, like, quite enough. I could even argue C tier, maybe. But I don't know. I take it quite often. If I wasn't having mage stuff going on, I would always take it over the other stuff in the B tier here. So on that alone, I think it needs to be at least in the B tier. There's definitely no way it's A tier. But it is just a general pick when nothing else makes sense. And it's okay for that. And in a similar sense, I would say this is right there with it. In the context of being level 4, this is definitely worse, but if I'm like level 5, which often 4-cost treasures, I am level 5 at the point I'm getting that, then this is basically as good as a power bag, and then it'll eventually be better. I don't know though, maybe because it's skewed in the wrong direction, you know, it's skewed toward health. I suppose a 2 over 4 is not as good as a 4 over 2, and the only advantage is once I get to 6, I get another 1 out of 2. I don't really think that's that good, as I think about it. And it sucks, obviously, to see it on Apprentice or something like that, or getting it ahead of curve even, which you could do with something like that. So for those reasons, I would actually have to say it, the principle of it alone, it really shouldn't be ranked higher than Power Bag. And I do find myself taking it less and less these days. Not actually that good. But it's okay. I think this is pretty bad. Somewhere between D and F. Top of F, bottom of D. I'll keep it in F. It's just like, it sucks. It's only there to help you tie. But it doesn't even do that well. Because if the final enemy attacks into you and died anyway, then it didn't even work. So it only really works that well in the specific situation of, like, you whittled them down to one giant unit in the back, like against an upgraded egg is probably the best scenario. But even then, if you're the last unit to attack, which 50% of the time will be the case, if you're the last unit to attack, it doesn't even kill it. This is really what it needs to read, is like, kill the highest health unit at the end of a fight once your units are gone, then it would be useful. Still wouldn't be amazing, but it would be useful. But as it stands, it hardly ever procs. And even if it does, all it's doing is helping you tie, and it may not even do that. So I think F tier for sure. It's a horrible, horrible treasure. Especially for a 4-cost. It should be like a 2-cost treasure, and I wouldn't even take it that much. Are those the 4s? I think that's all the 4s. Yep. Now, we got this move to a 5. I had mentioned it in another video, but I really don't think it's good anymore. And I don't think it needed to change to 5. I think it was properly statted for a 4. And like, yeah, it has a late game build that it has, but so what? So what? You know, it doesn't really pop off until Oberon. It doesn't make much sense as a 5 to me, because it's a very disappointing 5 to get. I'm tempted to even go F with it. I never do this build anymore because of this thing being on 5. I know that some people do, but I don't know. I've played against people that run this in the new form, and I'm never scared of it. I rarely am like being like, oh wow, they had that treasure and that's the reason I lost, you know? It's like Star Child just beats all of that shit anyway. Very specific situations for it to even be useful. You know what? I am just going to put it to F. It's fucking bad. The stars take too long to proc. If it's going to be a 5 cost, then they need to reduce the length of the stars at least. But like half these stars won't even shoot by the end of the game. Like it was a proper 4. A few people complained about it, and it's the problem of like, I don't think those complaints were valid, but whatever. I'll just never take it anymore. If they want it to be at a 5, so be it. This is a very specific treasure, but it is good when it is. And granted, you know, similar to the units, once we get to 5, everything becomes a bit more specific, so I can kind of rank it within the specific situations that it's good. But at the same time, if it ends up being very niche, I'm not going to rank it very high. And I do think this is pretty niche. Obviously, when cats are very spammable, this is really good because you'll often find pay dirt on it. But if, like, I don't find cats are very spammable right now, and neither are pirates. So if that's the case, this just isn't that good, but it is good when it is. You know, it's not like cats are unusable. I end up in them sometimes, and in those cases, this is a fine treasure. But otherwise, it's just useless, obviously. It can be okay with scam, but because it's a 5 cost and not a 6 cost, it's weird. It's like, all right, so let's say I know I'm moving towards scam because I have a demon board, right? Let's say I get a 5 cost, but I'm not 6 yet. And this is one of the options. Am I going to just take this knowing that it does nothing for me right now, when I could take something that does something for me right now? I guess that's a judgment call you have to make. But for what it's worth, it is very good with the scam build. The demon scam build specifically, because there's so many resummons going on. And I guess it's good with angels as well. But again, you got to get to 6 for that to happen. I guess Fortuna is the exception to the rule. So it is awkward at a 5 cost, that's what I will say about it. That's like only good with cats. Or theoretically, it could be good with pirates, but it isn't. Still a B though, because it's really good with cats. And this, I'm going to rank it as A, I guess. It's similar to this and that it only fits certain builds, but to me this is just a fluff treasure because I'm never running actual Slay, at least in the January month. Maybe now I will, if supposedly Hermes is really good and Woman of the Moon is really good, so this might even become better. But it's still like god tier with fluffs, and I run fluffs often enough that it hits pay dirt way more than this. And it is unfortunate that it is something at 5. I still have to take it speculatively, right? If, like, I'm fluffs, I have had games where I ended up taking it speculatively and then I died because I should have just took something that gave me immediate benefit. That's the tough payoff there, which almost makes me want to bump both of them down a tier. And honestly, I will. Just thinking about that, I think I'm going to bump them both down a tier. I think that they're speculative picks that can pay off, but in async, since you're losing so much health in the fifth level, it's probably just incorrect to take them most of the time. Now this one, I think will always be an S tier thing. Obviously there are times that you don't take it, but I think that's pretty rare. I think most builds, even if they don't currently have a booster, will be able to make use of one. So you could even take it speculatively, though. It probably goes down to like a B if it's a speculative pick, but I just find most of the time you're able to have a booster. I mean, the fact that Merlin just works with anything is prime example of that. And, you know, it works with stars, it works with hunters, it works with farmers, obviously. If boost was still a thing, it obviously works with that. It's really good with King Arthur in any general sense. It can even work with mages in that sense. Like, mages with a Merlin and a King Arthur is totally a thing. So it's pretty good. This one apparently got buffed, but we're just going to rank it on what it was, and that is just a shit fucking horribly statted thing as far as 5 costs go. I think it was a 5 over 3, or maybe a 6 over 3. The thing is, the game... Here's the thing about... Like, if I look at it in a vacuum and I'm ranking a 4 over 2 power bag in B and then a 6 over 4... 5 cost, you know, we're just going from 4 to 5 cost there, but context is everything here. In level 4, I'm looking at like 20 to 30 stat average units, typically in async. Whereas like now on level 5, I'm looking at like over 100 stats easily on a lot of units that I'm facing. So my needs are a lot different in terms of tempo oriented treasures. Like a power bag can get it done. Whatever this is can't. Now the new version is like double as good. I don't even know that it's enough at level 5, but certainly where I'm ranking it right now, it's the worst treasure we've seen so far. Even Mana Stone is better. You can get ahead of curve and it's okay, I guess. Now the scissors is similar to the witch, but it's much better. I would give it like a B. It is very dependent on the meta, of course, and just what you're facing in that lobby. But if, for example, I am scam, it's really good to have, because typically the first thing to kill you, your units aren't like high stats unless you're running mirror on the wall. So especially if there's something like dwarfs or fluffs or something, or farmers even, it just guarantees that first unit doesn't get to 2-for-1 you. Now obviously there are times it's wasted though, like if the unit attacks into you and died anyway, then it wastes the proc. So, maybe it's more like a C tier, honestly. It probably is like C tier, just in a general sense. But it's like a tech piece. It doesn't necessarily have general use, especially if you're running something that has high stats. Like, if you're running Fluffs or Dwarfs, you never want that. Gerlich Cabinet, I see as like... It's the same idea as the Witch cross, but it actually does its job. But again, it's not going to help you do anything. It used to be a little bit better when, you know, again, Van Helsing was a thing, because not that its main effect had any interaction with Van Helsing, but it gave you an extra attack was the main thing. So essentially, it was a 5-cost doing the same thing as a 2-cost, but it turns out that was still okay with hunters. Now it just doesn't matter that much. It's really only used to tie fights, but that's okay, I guess. Especially by level 5, when if I need it, I need it, and it can save me from death. But it's basically just a worse Chrono Crystal at that point, to a certain extent. And then the Helix, I think, is also kind of C tier. It's like, I don't like that it has to be in the first position. It doesn't make any sense to me that that is still a requirement with this thing. Like, there are times I take it and I forget to put it in the first position, and there's no giant indicator in saying that I should. There's no pop-up saying, like, hey, do you want to put your Hero Helix in the first slot? So it's just it's a completely pointless gotcha with the treasure. But even now that I remember to put it in slot 1, I still don't think it's that good. Like I said, it's like most hero powers are around a 4-cost treasure, if they're lucky, worth of value. So you're spending a 5-cost treasure to just get another 3 to 4-cost treasure effect. In some cases, it doesn't do hardly anything either, by the way. Like, for some of these heroes, they're not getting anything out of Hero Helix. But there are the rare heroes where it is pretty good. It just depends. It's very variant on what hero you have, I guess. But, it's pretty useless on some of them. Useless or underwhelming. And I would say it's the same idea with Hero Mask, except I would put it to like a B. It is better because, you know, with the Helix, you only get the hero you have. However, with the Hero Mask, I get a choice of new heroes. You know, a big nice array of them to choose from. And because it's a 5-cost, it's late enough in the game that you can start to cash in on some of those good late-game heroes like Aladdin or something. So you can get something like Aladdin or Hercules or Savitri or Daedalus, stuff like that with the Hero Mask if you're lucky, and it'll be amazing. Even like a Fisher King, just get a 6-cost treasure, or a Metamimic in some cases. But a Metamimic is just a Hero Helix, so is it really that good? Not really. But it's highly variant on what it does. Sometimes it does just brick you completely. Sometimes it's a completely wasted treasure, unfortunately. But that is why it's a B tier and not an S or an A. It's still generally going to hit, hopefully. It doesn't, though. It misses often enough that it feels like B tier. And Hall's Gold is really good. I would say probably S. S to A. I don't know. It's like the same idea as something like Weird Compass, except it's probably better. Is it? I don't know. It's very flexible, obviously. You just get a bunch of gold. I mean, what is there to say? They could probably stand to nerf it, but I hope they don't, because it's nice to just have a good 5-cost treasure. You'll notice when I compare, we were ranking a lot of these 4-costs pretty high, but the 5s aren't so good, right? I had mentioned it on the other video that I don't currently rank the Narcissus that high because the 5s just as a whole aren't that great. But there are some of the good ones, like this one and that one. But beyond that, there are not too many amazing ones. And that, I guess, is the... This is a 5 currently, except in the new patch it got moved to 6. We'll just rank it as such, that it's a 5 in the patch that I played. And it's just completely situational. I don't think it's generally useful, but I do think with mages it's very good, obviously. So you could still take it in a general sense, but I would fi I found when I did that, it hardly ever actually was good to do that. It was basically about as good as a double caster, because am I really gonna cast a expensive non-heavy spell that often if I'm not mages? Probably not. So it really just doesn't get that much value for a five cost if you're not mages. But I will, s because of that, it fits right in there with these, because it's the same idea. And then Philosopher's Stone is a five. I guess there's still a lot of more fives here. I'll go like A for Philosopher's Stone. It's very situational. I find it's best with like enchanters or boosters, right? Like if I can put a haymaker down there, that's great. If I can put a booster like a Merlin, that's great. If I can put like the tree or the stealth tree twig or whatever down there, that's amazing. Sometimes just like a blue puff is good enough. So it has a lot of use. Nero, it's really good with, even though Nero isn't really that good anymore. But it isn't S in my eyes because it does fall out of grace in a lot of the time. Because it is awkward to put a unit that you want to upgrade into slot 7 sometimes. Or alternatively, you have an already upgraded unit that absolutely wants to be in 7, so you just now you're not even getting anything out of it. And I've had that happen enough that I can't really give it an S in good conscience. But it is a good 5 cost for sure. And a lot of the times it is pretty impactful. Well, it's not bad enough to be F, but I'm gonna go D on the rotten apple. It just doesn't really do much. I would say generally this is better. Generally this is better. I mean, this can cast that spell sometimes anyway, but I would, in a general sense, say that if this casts Pigamorph, that's better. If this casts Starlight Strike, that's better. Even just buffing up my units in a lot of cases is better than this, especially when I consider this is a 4 and this is a 5. I had suggested that this should target the highest health enemy unit, and then it becomes pretty enticing. But didn't seem people like that, so I'll just continue to barely. I only take this if I'm like desperate and I need something and I'm about to die, and I'm like, all right, YOLO. Hopefully it hits the 1 out of 7 unit that it's useful on. Because that's unfortunately a lot of times to actually care about this, the odds aren't in your favor that it actually hits a unit you want. So, I don't know. And even like double casting it in some cases isn't even good because it could just hit the same unit twice, which happens 1 out of 7 times. But it's at least somewhat useful, so it's not F. And then the shard, probably put B. I'd much rather have the Philosopher's Stone than this. I find that the turn I can get a shard, I rarely am able to actually use it on the unit I want to, following acquiring it. So I have to like wait at least a round before it actually gives me any value. Alternatively, it also has a high chance of just fucking up and accidentally buying like a 2-cost unit, forgetting that you have it the longer and longer you go on without using it. So, you know, that's just a skill issue, but hey, happens to me enough that it is a thing. And you know, you don't get the treasure to go along with the unit, or anything like that. So all that being said though, it can be a pretty good power spike that you can set up. You know, if you can get a 6-cost unit, sometimes even a 5-cost unit is okay. Like if I only had one unupgraded haymaker, I am a-okay taking like another upgraded haymaker. If I already have some farmer stuff going on, I don't need to hold out for like the 6 costs necessarily. And in some cases, I may even want the haymaker more than some of those 6 costs to be upgraded. So definitely has its uses. Let's see, are any of the other ones here on 5? I don't think so. Hurricane should be. I'm sure Hurricane just should be like a 4 or something, but yeah, I don't think any of these others are 5 anymore. So now we're finally to the 6s, which is a really good pool, I gotta say. This is S. If this is S, then this is also S. And it's arguably better. Which is funny that it used to be a 5, because even as a 6, it's S. Too many builds I use have boosts as part of the thing. Fluffs. Farmers. Even to some degree mages. There are some times, I guess if I'm running dwarfs, I don't want it. I guess if I'm running scam, I don't want it. So there are times that I don't want it, but not enough for me to not make it an S. It's just too damn good. Stars, it's great with stars as well. And especially upcoming. I believe this was still in the patches I played. If it wasn't, my bad, but I'm not going to talk about it much. It's horrible. It's horrible. And I think it is removed from the game now, which is a good thing. And this is a similar thing to boost. It's like entrance. Arguably even better than the boost, because there's more stuff I think that uses entrance. You know, everything I named off, I guess Fluffs doesn't use it, but some of the other stuff like Dwarfs does use it, Stealth does use it, obviously Farmers uses it. Even Scam could use it. I mean, if you think about it, you may run Mirror on the Wall as a unit, but it's also a unit that could come out of Frankenstein, so like it's already useful there, especially coming out of Frankenstein. And it could be useful for stars, certainly in the new patch, since you can go over 7 generated stars. It's definitely useful, so it's just a pretty god tier treasure. I'll be honest, they could probably nerf it to a 7 cost, and it would still be one of the best 7 costs. But it's absolutely S, no question about it. This is between C or D. Apparently it's another one like this where they doubled the value, which is probably a good change. The problem is it just doesn't... It's C, because like... mainly because of its use in Scam and Cats. There really isn't much other use for it. If you're just getting a one-time flat increase on static units that aren't resummoning, then it really is pretty bad. I think even if you double the stats, which I think was the change, it's probably not that good. At least it has a little more impact if you get it early. But... gosh, I don't know. I think outside of summons, it really isn't that useful. And it's not even that amazing in summons, considering how high the stats get on a lot of stuff in the game. But for what it's worth, it can be all right. Old version of Dr. Frankenstein, this was really good, because it used to be able to summon Frankenstein's monster, which could actually get crap loads of attack if you had something like that. But I digress. It's not really all that good. And then this one used to be a 5 cost, 6 cost. Double the stats on your first unit. It's decent. It's an aura, so it technically can get doubled as the double, you know, for Magic Scarf. But I think there's enough times it's not that impactful enough to be that good of a six cost treasure, so I think it kind of averages out to a B. Now obviously if you can combine it with like a doppelganger on a unit that's gigantic, it's like S, but that's situational. I think there's just as many cases where it's just not that useful. Like in a scam build, it might not be that useful, for example. For cats, it's probably not that useful, even if you are resummoning stuff there. Yeah, just not that useful all the time. I think it was probably... It was like a S tier 5 cost, but I don't know that it translates that well to being a 6 cost. This is... So the harp... I don't know, it's C or D, I would say. In the, it's really good to find on Fisher King. It's really good to find ahead of curve, but I don't know how much I can rank something as being ahead of curve when most of the time it's not ahead of curve. And to have the limitation of not being able to play multiple fives and multiple sixes when that's the majority of what you want late game is a huge downside for not much upside. I mean, definitely the tempo that it provides is pretty good, but I would argue it's like Orchestra, for example, on most boards already gives more stats than this gives without having any real requirement other than just having the board that you already had assembled sort of be there. I suppose I still rank it C, though, because I have had enough games where it pulls me out of the depths of death for a few rounds, and then I just stop using it, and it's good for that. Like, it is technically pretty good tempo if you get it early. But I'm tempted to put it to D, but I'll leave it as C. Maybe I'll redo it later. And the Sintamati Stone is the opposite of this thing. It's like it gives you no immediate value, and it probably doesn't give you any value ever, if I'm being honest. There's just too many shitty sevens. Sometimes it even ruins your board. I've had it where I take it on a scam board, and it gave me what's normally a good treasure, which is the shields to the front. However, with scam, I can tell you right now it's not that good with scam, because it often makes it so if you're backlining a Frankenstein that the Frankenstein dies before any of the front units clear out, which is obviously an issue. Then you have to do weird stuff like run the Frankenstein up in slot 4 and just hope for the best. So it actually is just a risk to take it sometimes. Or it might give you like the fairy tale treasure, which is normally very good. However, if you were really searching for combining a unit, either for treasures or to combine their stats, and then now you can't do that, which sucks. I guess you're just hoping that you can like change your hero to a Fisher King or an amateur and replace that treasure at that point. But yeah, you're probably not gonna be able to do that. The fact of the matter is it's just too slow. You have to wait 2 entire turns to get what you get, and you don't even have the choice. You know, let's say I'm Fisher King, I get 1 choice, right? With this, you don't even get the choice to skip the item or re-roll it. It just puts it in your inventory, and you didn't have any say about it. So it can't be better than a C in my eyes. I could even argue D, probably. But I don't know. It's like the bottom of C. Maybe I'll move it to D. Then Doppelganger is very good. I don't know if it's S or A. I'm going to say S for now, though, because I feel like in most builds it's just super valuable. Every now and then you'll find it. Like, I guess it's not good with fluffs, and that's about it. I can't think of anything else it's not great with. It's just like I'll always be able to make use of this with most builds. And it has very interesting interactions some of the time. And then this is my most hated treasure in the game, hands down. I don't know how this... And it's another one I've given up on, trying to preach how imbalanced it is. and how unfun it is to play against. So when I'm playing this game, the one consistent thing that makes me stop and like just not play for a few days is Golden King. It's just ridiculously good for a 6 cost. And when you're playing against it, I mean, you've seen it on video, and it happens just as often off video. Like, it's between 15 or 20 damage to you. It, at minimum, doubles the effect of every unit on your board just for having to play down a measly one unit. It really should require you to play down 2 units, in my opinion, but the fact that Aura Bell doesn't is kind of funny, but like, and sometimes you don't even have a downside with it. For example, if you couple it with Doppelganger, it still procs, and then it procs the Doppelganger. So it's like, it's just ridiculous. And like I said, for whatever reason, auto battlers have it in their mind. This is not a unique problem to this game, but for whatever reason, they've determined that upgraded units need to do more damage to you than unupgraded units. I've never liked that in any auto battler ever. It doesn't make any sense to me. It's like, okay, we're rewarding the people that are high rolling again. So because they get to have a full frickin' upgraded board, now I get to take double the damage on everything? How does that make sense? Help it make sense to me. How is that fun? Because honestly, and you know, I'm getting riled up just thinking, I'm trying not to think about the times I've had to play against these stupid Golden King boards, but it's like, if I'm being honest, it makes me feel like I wasted my time playing the whole match when I end up dying to Golden King bullshit. It's like, if I would have known that I'm going to run into Golden King on round 14 and then right again on round 16, I would have loved to have known that before I wasted 30 minutes of my life, because there was nothing I could ever do in any scenario to compete with that, other than getting my own Golden King. But, you know, but like, there's nothing I can do in that scenario. I'm just going to die, and I'm going to go from full health to dead in 2 rounds because I face Mr. Golden King twice in a row, you know, essentially twice in a row. And that has happened a stupid amount of times to me in this game. Maybe the people that don't complain about it or think that it's a fine treasure just aren't running into these scenarios. I mean, that's another argument I've made. I'm like, there's so much variance in the game and in what you can face, you know, what blah, this and that. It's like, some people might just not run into this bullcrap the frequency that I run into it at. But I've had it happen. It doesn't matter what you run into with Golden King. Almost everything is going to full board kill you, do double the damage. And it's bad enough on most boards, but it gets really, really bad when it's like Scam. Because with Scam, it's like, I can even take out the whole board, but then I kill, like my last unit happens to kill the Dr. Frankenstein, and I literally have taken 20 damage in those scenarios. And let me tell you, I don't queue up for another game after that. I'm tempted to uninstall the game when that happens. A younger me would've. Not that I'm that level-headed, but if you could believe it, I'm much better than I used to be. And trust me, a younger me wouldn't put up with that for the amount that I've put up with. Yeah, Hurricane is dog shit. There's one use for it, I think, and that's if you're running Scam, it's okay. But no, it's just horrible. Now, Magic Scarf, on the other hand, just like the double entrance, just like the double boost, it's just amazing. There's so many good auras come late game. The two that come to mind for me are obviously Merlin. I mean, it's essentially the same thing as this in the context of Merlin. But also, like, I think maybe Fluff feels good to me now because the blue Fluff is an aura. so it does benefit from this. And in fact, as I've mentioned, you want Merlin also on your board, so when you find Magic Scarf on Fluffs, you're very happy. You are very happy. It's also just okay with some other stuff, like Hakot in a mage build. It's takeable. I suppose there are, every now and then, things where it's not useful on, obviously. Like, it's not useful in Dwarfs, it's not useful in Scam. It can be, though, because here's the thing. Keep in mind, a lot of the tempo stat-giving treasures are auras, so you can combine it with something like Orchestra, for example, to get double the value out of it, and then it is good with Scam. Then it is good with Cats. Oh, it's great with Cats anyway, because Aura Cat. Yeah, there's just so many ways for Scarf to be good. There's no way it's not S. It's just amazing. And then Merlin's book, I don't know. I'm going to put it just in the, we'll just call it the decent mage specific treasure tier here, which is half this tier. Because obviously if you're not doing mages, it's completely useless. So what use is it for me to say this in a tier list? It's just, it's great with mages. It's useless otherwise. If you get it ahead of curve, you can transition into it. You're inclined to, because it is that powerful with mages. But it is what it is. It's are you mages or are you not? And this is the only good late game tempo treasure, at least in the patches that I played. But I still think it only leaves it at a B tier, because even though it gives you a ton of stats, way more than any other tempo treasure at that point in the game, even though it does that, it's still not that useful in a lot of cases. You know, it's not going to be what the difference maker in winning or losing a fight in a lot of cases. If you get it, especially if you get it late, you know, you need to get it a early six or ahead of curve for it to really be devastating. And it, trust me, it is devastating in those scenarios. Like on Fisher King, Orchestra is like hilariously powerful, but, or if you pirate map it or something, but like, it does fall off pretty quick when the late game scaling gets out of control. You know, what is difference does this make when your fluffs are over 1,000,000? Or your dwarfs or whatever, or your farmer build, or your stealth build. You know, it just is it rounds down to being irrelevant in that case. So as good as it is for tempo, I can't really rank it above B. And this is apparently getting buffed, which I think it should. It's just pretty slow. It's takeable. That's the best I can give it. It's not even really. It is something that's good ahead of curve. So it's like, I feel like the C6 costs kind of fall into that. It's like, well, they're good ahead of curve, otherwise they suck. And that's pretty much Piece of Infinity. You know, if you get it late game, you don't have enough time for it to be relevant. If you get it ahead of curve, it can be relevant. You know, you can actually have it make your board pretty big and maybe turn some units into some beasts. It is getting buffed, though, so maybe the new version's all right. I would probably go A on the on this. It's infinitely better than the Sintamati Stone, but I don't know that I would. Here's the thing. Most of my late-game builds, everything, all of these sixes that I listed as S, double boost, double scarf, double entrance, double doppelganger, or double ganger, golden king, all of those, 19 times out of 20, I'm going to take those ahead of a treasure chest. Absolutely, I am. So there's no way I can actually rank it up there. But if I'm already, like, once I have acquired all of those things for my respective build, then I'll actually take the treasure chest if it seems like the fight is going to go on long enough. Rarely it does, though. Rarely it does. Let's see. That one is removed from the patch. Oh, and I guess this fluctuated a lot last month, but I'll rank it on what it was at the end of the month, which was a 5 cost basically useless treasure, if I'm being honest. It's like, you could use it with the angels and the demons, and that's about it. As a 5 cost. It was completely useless. I don't even know if there's much worth talking about it. It's always been incredibly OP or incredibly useless. There's never really been any in between with that treasure. And that's all of the sixes that were there. And then we have Aladdin's Lamp. I'd go D. Technically it can be fun to try to make it happen, but I think I have 300 hours into this game. I really can't tell you that Aladdin's Lamp has been worth it, aside from one or two games total, if I'm being honest. Most of the time, even when it pops, it's completely irrelevant to me winning or losing. It's like the definition of win more. I think the only times it could actually change anything significantly is if you get World Tree out of it. That's really the only thing I think it can be worth, but it's so fucking slow. And if you sent a Monty Stone into that, it's pretty sad. It's like, wow, so I'm just not getting my 6 cost treasure, or 7 or whatever. Now this, on the other hand, is pretty much the best 7 cost. It's one of the only worthwhile 7 costs. I think another thing I don't like about the Centimeter Stone that I kind of mentioned was there's a lot of bad 7 costs. But this one, it's like, there is something to be said that it can be countered by a level 2 treasure, but most of the time by that point in the game, they're not going to have that treasure. So they would have to cast either Earthquake or the Blizzard spell, but they aren't always going to be offered that. Sometimes they can, and it would counter you if you're running a static build, but it doesn't counter you if you're running resummons, for example, like with cats. This is probably the craziest treasure with cats, because there's not a whole lot you can do against somebody that's running cats with this. You really have to go flying at that point to really do anything against them, and you may not even... If they have enough aura cats, that may just not even matter. They could even stealth the aura cats at a certain point with the item, and then there's nothing you can do. If you just have these cats, and if you have Duelist on top of it, it's like there's just so many units coming back in with a shield that it's pretty hard to beat. But I think even with a static build, it's really powerful. It can often just end up in 2-for-1s on every single frontline unit, as long as they don't cast the two spells that counter it. And that's pretty S tier in my opinion. Then there's the Excalibur, which, I don't know, it has some rare situations. Sorry, I had to get the music back. But it has some rare situations where it can pop off, but like, obviously, it's really good with a Fire Mage. It can be good with Doppelganger. It can be good with, like, a good boy, except you're only getting the attack portion. But that might be good enough. Could be good with, like, a Star Child or an Oberon. So there's obviously a lot of use cases for it, but there are, in my experience, quite a lot of use cases also where it was completely irrelevant. So I think it just averages out to being a B. I'm not that excited to see it, honestly, most of the time. But I can sometimes make use of it. And then this is the Excalibur Shard. I'm just going to go C tier on it because it doesn't do anything the turn you get it. And that's a problem. And you may just have a mainly upgraded board already anyway. I've had a lot of games where I died holding an Excalibur Shard. A lot of games. But if you can survive, then, and you had a bunch of unupgraded units, then obviously it's very good. So it's very swingy in what it can do for you. But in a general sense, I don't think it's that consistently good. Just given the context of when you get it. Now, FairyTale's really pretty good. Maybe I'm not as high on it as most people. To me, I think that Golden King is literally more powerful than it. If this was a 7, to me, it's already more powerful than the Shard, and it's already more powerful than FairyTale, to put things in perspective. That being said, I mean, if the times that FairyTale is crazy is when it's ahead of curve, right? And there is really no curve for 7 necessarily, but I'm talking like, you know, if you get it really early, it's basically like you're facing a Golden King, except now they can play 7 units instead of 6. It's really not much different, though. It's not like any more or less oppressive than Golden King, and at least it's a 7 cost, so it felt like it was less, it's less frequent that I run into a FairyTale board, whereas with the Golden King boards I run into all the fucking time. But I think on principle alone I would put it below S. You can't get treasures anymore, which does suck. So, like, yeah, it's good. It's, I think, a little overrated, though. And Golden Mimic, this is one that used to be a 6. It's in a weird spot because it's like too powerful to be a 6, but not that good as a 7. I don't know, I'd probably go C. Here's the thing, there are obviously some situations where it's insanely good. But in my experience, a lot of time when you're getting a 7, you may have done it. It's just the context. It's like, are you getting this 7 already having good 6s? If so, great. Baby Mimic is S tier. Or you know, whatever this is called is S tier. But are you getting your 7 at the, you know, from something else, like a treasure map, where you're getting it ahead of curve? In that case, I'm probably only holding like level 4 treasures, maybe not even that. Then this is really not that good. I could take it for something that doesn't have immediate huge benefit that eventually has huge benefit. But again, we're talking async here. You don't have that luxury. So I rarely find myself able to actually take this option at 7 cost, which is why I'm paying it at a C cost. Because, you know, we go back in the pirate map scenario. Infinitely, I'd much rather have this. Just get immediate huge value. Or even the fairy tale, right? Or even the Excalibur. I want immediate impact. I want to crush the lobby, or alternatively, if I'm dying, I want to survive. This isn't going to help that in that case. So it's just not good at that. What else do we got here? Infinity. This is getting buffed, so maybe it'll be good in the future. Yeah, I mean, it can't really rank it that much higher than Piece of Infinity. It starts out at about the same stats, and it slowly grows. It's just too damn slow. It's like, if Piece Infinity is C-tier, then why would Infinity not be also C-tier? That's essentially what it comes down to. You know, I could see it being a 6 cost and still not necessarily being that good. I would never take it over the likes of these. Ever. Like, ever, ever. Yeah, just too slow. I mean, I take it from time to time because 7 costs suck, and it's sometimes just the best option. I guess this one was still in there as well. And it's like the saddest 7 cost to get. I got that, unfortunately, a few times from Cinemati Stone. I guess it's better than Aladdin's Lamp. Is it? I don't know. By that point in the game, 50 attack is completely irrelevant. completely irrelevant. You know, that just has no purpose. Now, luckily, I think they removed that from the game, which is great. And I think this is the final 7 cost. Nope, this is not the final 7 cost. There's a few more. This is the... I'm just going to put it right there with the Mage Treasures. It basically casts your spell, your targeted spell, to everything. It's really no different than the Broken Spell Reflector, other than it's just a better version of it. It makes it just about as useful. You know, if you don't have Mage Treasures already, or the mage setup, it's not actually gonna be that good. But if you do, it's really good. Really, really, really good. And then there's the Golden Chalice, which is, it's okay. I would rather have that than FairyTale in a lot of cases, because it gives you the upgraded unit just the same, but you get a treasure right along with it. And then after you've done 2 of them, you can still keep combining stuff for treasures. I still don't think it's worth putting in the S, though, because it still is, like, a little bit slow. I don't know. I could argue S on this one. I just don't ever see myself taking this over this, though. There's not really any situation I take this... or I take anything over this 7 cost, other than if I'm already scammed. That's about the only situation, but it's not enough to, like, put this up here or anything. So we'll just put it ahead of the Fairy Tale, but they're essentially pretty similar. And then this is the final 7 cost, and it's pretty bad. I guess I'll go D. As bad as it is, at least it can have a use sometimes when you get it ahead of curve. But it's so bad, it's like 14 over 7, come on. For a 7 cost. Tell me if Golden King or that is better. You better give me the right answer. And then I'm not even going to rank the 8s. Really? Well, okay. I'll just quickly do them, and I can't rank them. Here's my problem. I literally have never gotten this to even know. I can just take other people's word on it that it was great. I've gotten 8s so little in this game that I haven't even taken them all at a certain point. Like, I could tell you that this is a good one, and I can tell you that this is a good one, the Zeus's Lightning. I can't really speak to anything else other than that all of the tempo-related ones suck for 8. You know, Infinity sucks. Making your shop have stats sucks. We're talking way late game here, right? Giving your board 30-30 or whatever sucks for an 8 cost. In my opinion, it sucks. Even casting a spell 14 times, I guess, is good. I've taken that one 2 times only to just win the game anyway without ever casting that. You know, I never got it to actually use it. And that's kind of how these are. It's like they're just a meme to me. Probably the best. The two relevant ones are Zeus's Lightning and the tree. And I guess in the context of async, if I were to get offered the Pot of Gold, which I've literally never been offered, it would be great in async because you got all the time in the world to make the exact board that you want. But I'm not even going to rank them because, honestly, I see them so little that why would I even bother? I literally, you know, like I said, I think I've played 300 hours in this thing now, and I've gotten like 3 level 8 treasures, I think, offered in my whole time there. So, whatever. Yeah, that's how I feel about it. You'll notice that the best, probably, tiers here are 4 and 6 on that latest patch. And then other ones like 5 and 7 are pretty bad. 2 kind of sucks. 3 is like middle of the road. So you know which areas you want to try to really get some triples on, in my opinion. But yeah, as always, thanks for watching, and until next time, peace.